24th Sunday after Pentecost. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
The College for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee. We glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, our most high in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
From the tribe of Bartholomew and the tribe of Bartholomew.
discerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief, for you are all children of the light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Please be seated. Having served as diocesan stewardship officer for a term in Milwaukee, I was always on the lookout for biblical passages relevant for building effective stewardship sermons. I found this from Google February 20, 2005. The Bible offers 500 verses on prayer, fewer than 500 verses on faith, and more than 2,000 verses on money. In fact, 15% of everything Jesus ever taught was on the topic of money and possessions, more than his teachings on heaven and hell combined. The parable of the talents is an ideal sermon builder for a stewardship theme. We often talk about stewardship of talent, time, and treasure, and one can relate this parable to all three themes. There are, as some of you know, gift assessment tools that churches use to help members discover gifts that they have that could be helpful in the local church or diocese. For example, an accountant might be the ideal candidate to serve as church treasurer. A music teacher might relish leading the choir. These are gifts or talents that could be related to the parable of the talents. In fact, our use of the word talent as an aptitude grows out of the biblical talent, which was a measure of money. In recruiting members for church ministries, I've used the phrase, God doesn't choose the fit, rather, he fits those whom he chooses. A willingness to serve and be filled with the Holy Spirit is most needed in offering whatever talent we have. If one member can pledge the equivalent of 5 talents to the annual budget, and another can only afford to pledge the equivalent of 2 talents, and another only the equivalent of 1 talent, that is perfectly okay. People are giving sacrificially out of what they can actually afford to give. As to raw talent or ability, there are only a few as talented as, say, LeBron James, and many hundreds of thousands of weekend athletes, but we work with what we are blessed with. I'd always taken the parable of the talents at face value, the learning being that we should expend our best effort to produce the maximum profit for our boss. The 5 and the 2 talent men did their best according to their ability, while the lazy, slothful third servant did nothing to increase the master's wealth, only burying his 1 talent in the ground. Moral of the story, don't waste the opportunities and talents you have been given. My old boss in the life insurance business used to say, do something, even if it's wrong. I'm quite aware that an important theme in Luke's gospel is the use or misuse of money, and how Christians are to deal with wealth. The story of Lazarus and Dives clearly underlines Luke's concern for the poor and his contempt for the uber-rich who cast their breadcrumbs to poor men and hungry dogs. I remember reading a commentary that imagined Dives wiping the meat grease from his face and hands and tossing away whole chunks of bread which he had used as a napkin. Kind of a revolting image. Today's text uses the Greek word doulos to describe the recipients of the talents. Slave has so many negative connotations in the American context that I prefer to use servants instead of slaves. There are some scholars who use the term retainers instead of slave or servant, as the 3 recipients of the talents were expected to act on behalf of the owner or nobleman, but had some degree of freedom as to how they would behave in the nobleman's absence. With this in mind, an article by Professor Herzog, The Vulnerability of the Whistleblower, on the parable of the talents was an eye-opener to me. In his section, The Nobleman and His Retainers, Herzog writes, the parable can be divided into 3 themes. Number 1, the distribution of wealth. Number 2, the business venture. And 3, the reckoning. 1 talent is no mean amount of money to place in another's hands. So all 3 retainers had some status in the nobleman's household. They all knew the business climate and culture in which they were expected to participate. They knew that exploiting the peasants or villagers who were part of the nobleman's holdings would be their key to being able to earn some extra for themselves. I had never thought about the possibility that the retainers were not only creating additional wealth for the nobleman, but also some for themselves in the process. In my previous interpretation of the parable, it never occurred to me that Luke was servant was banished into the grinding poverty that he was critiquing. Even free peasants lived with the constant pressure of tributes to Rome and the tax system. It must have been a crisis of conscience that prompted the third servant to speak out in critique of his master and the corrupt economic system that he was benefiting from. It's a very different view of this parable to imagine that the theme of the whistleblower bravely stepping out against an oppressive economic system, only to be banished into that cruel existence himself. Brad Young, in the parable of Jewish tradition and Christian interpretation, takes a slightly more nuanced position about the intentions of the third retainer. Different from what I've taken in the past, instead of seeing him as simply lazy and fearful, Young suggests that the third retainer had good intentions. That is, above all, he did not want to lose any of the master's money. While Herzog posits that the third retainer was sick of the inequity and cruelty of the economic system and out of principle refused to participate in it any longer. I credit the online course that I just completed on the parables for these fresh insights into the familiar parable of the talents. Lord, help us to be aware of and to oppose oppressive economic systems in our day. I invite you to stand and join me in affirming our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge the baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. We all heart and with all mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to our Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, and for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our bishop and all clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our president and president-elect, for the leaders of the nations and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this village, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for an abundance of fruits of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel on land, on water, or in the air, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the celebration of birthdays of Mark Human, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and suffering, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those serving in the armed forces and their families, especially Jason Thompson, David Marcinski, Mark Ditchman, Kyle Lewis, Paul Workman, Becca Boyd, C.J. Boyd, Jack Rolfe, Anthony. any worse. Patrick Renwick, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Vinny, Macy, Josh, Richard and Mary, Art and Patsy, Tom and Joanna, Mary and Nancy, Bob and Fran, Christian and Giselle, Greg, Jane, Diane, Amy, Nancy, Father Jim, Lena, Teresa, Tony, Myron, Margaret, Marie, Dan, Joe, Jennifer, Emmanuel, Lucy, Susan, Elizabeth, Molly, Lauren, Cynthia, Al, Denali, Wyatt, Jesse, Richie, Jay, Shirley, Dale, Billy, Nick, Julie, Kathy, Steve, Judy, Betty, John, Karen, William, Tony, Quentin, Ronnie, and Mike. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who have died in the hope of resurrection, and for all who have departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and depression, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the communion of Saint Bartholomew and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our Lord.
To thee, O Lord, our God.
For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. I want to say a couple of things about convention before Linda does the other announcements. We had a virtual convention this year, and it was difficult. I think the diocesan staff put a lot of hours into putting the whole thing together. It worked pretty well. There were a few glitches, but for the most part, it went well. David LePage was our lay representative, and he sent me a little report. He said, I attended the convention this year via Zoom. This was my first convention. Overall, I thought it went very well. There were a few bobbles here and there, but we were able to effectively hear comments and debate. And the voting mechanism worked fine. The only thing I missed was the inter-parish socialization, and so I would be happy to volunteer for this next year. So that's good news. One thing I wanted to mention to you, and this is relevant for us, is the bishop in his address said that there's a possibility that he may decide to shut down indoor worship if things continue to get worse in terms of the virus. And if that is the case, then we will continue to have our virtual worship, and thanks very much to Chaney and Andy for putting this together for us. And so those will be available on YouTube. And if we have to go back totally to online, we'll probably be recording them on Fridays and broadcasting them on the weekend. So that's something to pray about. I love the fact that we can be back together, but we want to be safe too, and that's very important. So, Linda?
Vestry will meet tomorrow evening at 5:45 in the parish hall. When we have vestry meetings on a Monday, there is not Bible study. So we have our vestry meeting tomorrow. If you have any suggestions for me to bring up at the meeting, You can text, email, or you can call me. Epiphany will use the community meal funds to buy the frozen turkeys for the Thanksgiving meal boxes. We can donate the following items: 5-pound bag of potatoes, box or bag of stuffing, canned cranberries, canned vegetables, canned yams. Please put the item or items you would like to donate outside Father Steve's office. I see there's some there today. That's wonderful. The meals will be distributed on November 21st.
So they need to deliver them by Friday to my office.
This Friday?
Yes.
Okay. So if you want to just deliver, bring them by Friday by his office, by Father's office. We continue to collect food and taxables for the Willoughby Food Bank. Please, please fill out and turn in your pledge cards. Vestry will need to approve next year's budget at the December Vestry meeting. So please get those in. Does anybody have anything to add? TV Father? See you later.
Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people. In your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son, his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with St. Bartholomew and all your saints, we can enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and you, God Almighty,